We really do not care a preference to declare.
A bias to disclose would be indelicate.
And therefore we propose to let impartial fates elect for us a mate.
Thank you. grandee from the Spanish shore. The noble Duke of Plaza's hall. I regret that I am unable to pay my state visit on a horse. As a Castilian Hidalgo of that description, I should have preferred to ride through the streets of Venice, but owing, I presume, to an unusually wet season, the streets are in such a condition that equestrian exercise is impracticable. No matter. Where's our suite?
Your Grace, I am here.
Why do you not do yourself the honor to kneel when you address His Grace?
My love, it is so small a matter. Still, you may as well do it.
The young man seems to entertain but an imperfect appreciation of the respect due from a meal to a Castilian Hidalgo.
Child, you are hard upon our sweet.
Papa, I have no patience with the presumption of persons of his plebeian position. If he does not appreciate that position, let him be whipped until he does.
Well, let us hope the omission was not intended as a slight. I should be much hurt if I thought it was. So would he. Where are the halberdiers who were to have had the honor of meeting us here, that our visit to the Grand Inquisitor might be made in becoming state?
Your Grace! Your Grace, the halberdiers are mercenary people who stipulated for a trifle on account.
How tiresome. Well, let us hope the Grand Inquisitor is a blind gentleman. And the band, who were to have had the honor of escorting us? I see no band.
Your Grace, the band are sordid persons who require to be paid in advance.
That's so like a band.
Insuperable difficulties meet me at every turn.
But surely they know His Grace.
Exactly.
No, His Grace.
Let us hope that the Grand Inquisitor is a deaf gentleman. A cornet a piston would be something. You do not happen to possess the accomplishment of tootling like a cornet a piston.
Alas, no, Your Grace. But I can imitate a farmyard.
Help us. I don't see how we could bring it in.
It would not help us in the least. We are not a parcel of graziers come to market. Don't.
Oh, our sweet feelings. Be so good as to ring the bell and inform the Grand Inquisitor that His Grace, the Duke of Plaza Toro, Count Matadoro, Baron Picadoro,
and sweet,
have arrived at Venice and seek,
desire,
demand,
and demand an audience.
Your Grace has but to command.
I felt sure of it. I felt sure of it. And now, my love, shall we tell her? I think so. And now, my love, prepare for a magnificent surprise. It is my agreeable duty to reveal to you a secret that should make you the happiest young lady in Venice.
A secret?
A secret which for state reasons it has been necessary to preserve for 20 years.
When you were a prattling babe of 6 months old, you were married by proxy to no less a personage than the infant son and heir of this majesty, the immeasurably wealthy King of Barataria.
Married to the infant son of the King of Barataria? Was I consulted? Then it was a most unpardonable liberty.
Consider his extreme youth and forgive him. Shortly after the ceremony, that misguided monarch abandoned the creed of his forefathers and became a Wesleyan Methodist of the most bigoted, persecuting type. The Grand Inquisitor, determined that the innovation should not be perpetuated in Barataria, caused your smiling and unconscious husband to be stolen and conveyed to Venice. A fortnight since, the Methodist monarch and all his Wesleyan court were killed in an insurrection, and we are here to ascertain the whereabouts of your husband and to hail you, our daughter, as Her Majesty, the reigning Queen of Barataria.
Your Majesty.
It is at such moments as these that one feels how necessary it is to travel with a full band.
Hi. Nothing to wear. We're practically penniless.
That point has not escaped me. Although I am unhappily in straitened circumstances at present, my social influence is something enormous, and the company, to be called the Duke of Plazatoro Limited, is in course of formation to work me. An influential directorate has been secured, and I shall myself join the board after allotment.
Am I to understand that the Queen of Barataria may be called upon at any time to witness her honored sire in process of liquidation?
Liquidation is not exempt from that drawback. If your father should stop, it will of course be necessary to wind him up.
But it's so degrading. It's so undignified. A grandee of Spain turned into a public company. Such a thing was never heard of.
My child, the Duke of Plazatoro does not follow fashions. He leads them. He always leads everybody. When he was in the army, he led his regiment. He occasionally led them into action. He invariably led them out of it.
In enterprise of martial kind, when there was any fighting, he led his regiment from behind. He found it less exciting. But when away his regiment ran, his place was at the foro. That celebrated, cultivated, underrated nobleman, the Duke of Plazatoro.
In the first and foremost mind, aha, you always found that mind, aha, that celebrated, cultivated, underrated nobleman, the Duke of Plazatoro.
When to evade destruction's hand to hide, they all proceeded. No soldier in that gallant band hid half as well as he did. He lay concealed throughout the war, and so preserved his coro. That unaffected, undetected, well-connected warrior, the Duke of Plazatoro.
In every dose he did, aha, he always took the lead.
Aha, that unaffected, undetected, well-connected warrior, the Duke of Plazatoro.
When told that they would all be shot unless they left the service, that hero hesitated not, so marvelous his nervous. He sent his resignation in the first of all his coro. That very knowing, overflowing, easygoing pattern in the dawn of Mar-a-Lago.
Oh, learnt, to my surprise and indignation, that I was married in babyhood to the infant son of the King of Barataria.
The son of the King of Barataria? The child who was stolen in infancy by the Inquisition?
The same, but of course you know his story.
Know his story? Why, I have often told you that my mother was the nurse to whose charge he was entrusted.
True. I had forgotten. Well, he has been discovered, and my father has brought me here to claim his hand.
But you will not recognize this marriage. It took place when you were too young to understand its import.
Nay, Luis, respect my principles and cease to torture me with vain entreaties. Henceforth, my life is another's.
But stay. The present and the future, they are another's. But the past, that at least is ours, and none can take it from us. As we may revel in naught else, let us revel in that.
I don't think I grasp your meaning.
Yet it is logical enough. You say you cease to love me.
I say I may not love you.
Ah, but you do not say you did not love me.
I loved you with a frenzy that words are powerless to express. And that but 10 brief minutes since.
Exactly, my own. That is until 10 minutes since, my own. My lately loved, my recently adored. Tell me that until, say, a quarter of an hour ago, I was all in all to thee.
I see your idea. It's ingenious. But don't do that.
There can be no harm in reveling in the past.
None whatever. But an embrace cannot be taken to act retrospectively.
Perhaps not.
You may recollect an embrace. I recollect many. But we must not repeat them.
Then let us recollect a few.
Alone, a war.
present to you his distinction, Don Alhambra del Bolero, the Grand Inquisitor of Spain. It was his distinction who so thoughtfully abstracted your infant husband and brought him to Venice.
So this is the little lady who is so unexpectedly called upon to assume the functions of royalty. And a very nice little lady, too.
Jim, isn't she?
Distinctly, Jim. Allow me. Ooh, naughty temper.
You must make some allowance. Her Majesty's head is a little turned by her access of dignity.
I could have wished that Her Majesty's access of dignity had turned it in this direction.
Unfortunately, if I'm not mistaken, there appears to be some little doubt as to His Majesty's whereabouts.
A doubt as to his whereabouts? Then we may yet be saved.
Doubt? Oh dear, no. No doubt at all. He is here in Venice, plying the modest but picturesque calling of a gondolier. I can give you his address. I see him every day. In the entire annals of our history, there is absolutely no circumstance so entirely free from all manner of doubt of any kind whatever. Listen, I'll tell you all about it. I stole the prince and I brought him here and left him gaily prattling with a highly respectable gondolier who promised the royal babe to rear and teach him the trade of a timonier with his own beloved Brackley. Both of the babes were strong and stout and considering all things clever. Of that there is
Instagram.
His mother is at present the wife of a highly respectable and old-established brigand who carries on an extensive practice in the mountains around Essex Junction. Accompanied by two of my emissaries, he will set out at once for her address. She will return with them, and if she finds any difficulty in making up her mind, the persuasive influence of the torture chamber will jog her memory.
God bless my heart! Consider my position! I am the wife of God! That's very clear! But who can tell except my intuition? Which is the prince? And which the gondolier?
Submit to fate without unseemly wrangle. Such complications frequently occur. Life is one closely complicated tangle. Death is the only true unravel.
Try we life long, we can never straighten out thy stain of skin. Why should we in vain endeavor guess and guess? And
That is the sort of king I would be.
So would I.
Come, I'm glad to see your objections are not insuperable.
Oh, they're not insuperable.
No, they're not insuperable.
Besides, we're open to conviction.
They're open to conviction?
Oh, they've often been convicted.
Our thoughts may have been hastily formed on insufficient grounds. They may be crude, ill-digested, erroneous. I have a very poor opinion of the politician who is not open to conviction.
Oh, he's a fine fellow.
Yes, that's the sort of politician for my money.
Then we'll consider it settled. Now, as the country is in a state of insurrection, it is absolutely necessary that you assume the functions of royalty at once. And until it is ascertained which of you is the king, I've arranged for you to reign jointly so that no question can arise hereafter as to the validity of any of your acts.
As one individual?
As one individual.
Like this?
Something like that.
And we may take our friends with us and give them places about the court?
Undoubtedly, that's always done.
I'm convinced.
So am I.
And the sooner we're off, the better.
Tell us what home and pack up a few things.
Stop! That won't do at all. Ladies are not admitted.
What?
Not admitted. Not at present. Afterward, perhaps. We'll see.
Why, you don't mean you're going to separate us from our wives?
This is extremely awkward. Only for a time. A few months. What's a few months?
But we've only been married half an hour.
Should no doubt be horrified, but I could marry.
howdy do, and her how are you? And I trust I see you well.
Wherever they go. jets away. Our island crown awaits me. Conflicting feelings rend my soul apart. The thought of royal dignity elates me. But leaving thee behind me breaks my heart.
Farewell, my love. On board you must be getting. But when upon the sea you really roam, remember that I
we are much obliged to you for your expressions of satisfaction and good feeling. I say we are much obliged to you for your expressions of satisfaction and good feeling.
We heard you.
We're delighted at any time to fall in with sentiments so charmingly expressed.
That's all right.
At the same time, there is just one little grievance that we should like to ventilate.
What?
Don't be alarmed. It's not serious. It is arranged that until it is decided which of the two of us is the actual king, that we are to act as one person.
Exactly.
Now, although we act as one person, we are, in point of fact, two persons.
We can't get into that. That's an alternative fact. Alternative facts are solemn things. Situated as we are, we can't recognize two independent responsibilities.
No, but you can recognize two independent appetites. It's all very well to say that we act as one person, but when you supply us with only one ration between us, I should describe it as an alternative fact carried a little too far.
It's a rather nice point. I don't like to express an opinion offhand. Suppose we reserve an argument before the full court.
Yes, but what are we to do in the meantime?
We want our tea!
I suppose that we may issue an interim order for double rations upon your majesty's entering into the usual undertaking to indemnify in the event of an adverse decision.
That, I think, will meet the case, but you must work hard.
Stick to it.
Nothing like work.
Oh, certainly. We quite understand that a man who has the magnificent position of king should do something to justify it. We are called your majesty. We are allowed to buy ourselves magnificent clothes. Our subjects often nod to us in the streets. Our sentries always return our salutes. And we enjoy the inestimable privilege of heading the subscription list to all the principal charities. In return for these advantages, the least we can do is make ourselves useful about the palace. Rising early in the morning, we proceed to light the fire. Then our majesty adorning in its workaday attire, we embark without delay on the duties of the day. First we polish off some batches of political dispatches and foreign politicians circumvent. Then if business isn't heavy, we may hold a royal levy or ratify some act of parliament. Then we probably review the house of troops with the usual shallow hunts or shallow hoops, or receive with ceremonial and state an interesting Eastern potentate. After that, we generally go and dress our private valet. It's a rather nervous duty. He's a touchy little man. Writes a literary for our private secretary. He is shaky in his spelling, so we help him if we can. And in group of craving center, we go down and order dinner, and we polish the regalia and the coronation plate. Spend an hour into debating all our gentlemen in waiting while we run our little errands for the ministers of state. Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of the king, but the duties are delightful and the privilege is great. But the privilege and pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is to run our little errands for the ministers. Particular to do. We may make a proclamation or receive a deputation or possibly create a peer or two. Then we help a fellow creature on his path with the garter or the thistle or the bath. Or we dress and toddle off in semi-state to a festival. function or effect. Then we go and stand a sentry at the palace private entry, marching hither, marching thither, up and down and to and fro, while the warrior on duty goes in search of beer and booty. And it generally happens that he hasn't far to go. He relieves us when he's able, just in time to lay the table, and we dine and serve the coffee, and at 12:30 or 1. With a pleasure that's emphatic, we retire to our attic with the gratifying feeling that our duty has been done. Oh, philosophers may sing of the troubles of the king, that of pleasures there are many and of worries there are none, but the culminating pleasure that we treasure beyond measure is the gratifying feeling that our duty.
It makes one feel quite selfish. It almost seems like taking advantage of their good nature.
How nice they were about the double rations.
Most considerate. But there's only one thing wanting to make us thoroughly comfortable.
And that is?
Our dear little wives that we left behind us 3 months ago.
Yes. It is dull without female society. We can do without everything else, but we can't do without that.
And if we had that, in perfection, we'd have everything. There is only one recipe for perfect happiness. Take a pair of sparkling eyes in endeavor and the nod in a merciful eclipse. Do not heed the mass surprise, having passed the Rubicon. Take a pair of rosy lips. Take a figure trimly bland, such as admiration wears. Be particular in this, take a tender little hand, fringe with dainty fingers. Press it, press it, in parentheses.
If you can, act upon it if you can. crawled by and you never wrote. So at last I said to Janetta, I can't stand this any longer. Those two poor monarchs haven't got anyone to mend their stockings or patch their clothes or sew on their buttons. At least I hope they haven't. Let us all pack up a change and go and see how they're getting on. And she said,
done.
And they all said,
done.
And we asked old Jacopo to lend us his boat. And he said,
done.
And we crossed the sea and thank goodness that's done. And here we are and I've done.
And now, which one of you is king?
And which of us is queen?
That we shan't know until nurse turns up. But never mind that. The question is, how shall we celebrate the commencement of our honeymoon? Gentlemen!
Yes?
Would you permit us to give you a magnificent banquet?
We will!
Thanks very much. And ladies?
Yes?
What do you say to a dance?
A banquet and a dance? Oh, it's too much happiness!
Pressure of the conversation.
You see, the monarchy has been remodeled on the principles of the Republic.
What?
All departments rank equally, and everybody is at the head of his department.
I see. I'm afraid you're annoyed. No, I won't say that. It's not quite what I expected.
I'm awfully sorry.
So am I.
Oh, by the by, can I offer you something after your voyage? A plate of macaroni and a rusk?
No, nothing. Nothing.
Obliged to be careful.
Yes. Gout. You see, in every court there are distinctions which must be maintained.
There are there?
Why, of course. For instance, you wouldn't have a Lord High Chancellor play leapfrog with his own cook.
Why not?
Why not? Because a Lord High Chancellor is a personage of great dignity who must under no circumstances
place himself in the position of being told to tuck in his tuppenny, except by a nobleman of his own rank. A Lord High Archbishop, perhaps, might tell a Lord High Chancellor to tuck in his tuppenny, but certainly not a cook, gentlemen. Certainly not a cook.
Not even if it's a Lord High cook?
My good friend, that is a rank which is not recognized in the Lord Chamberlain's office. No, it won't do. I'll give you an instance in which the experiment was tried. Many years ago, when you, whichever you are, were a baby, you
whichever you are, were married to a little girl who has grown up to be the most beautiful young lady in Spain. That beautiful young lady will be here to claim you, whichever you are, in half an hour. And I congratulate that one, whichever it is, with all my heart.
Married when a baby?
But we were married 3 months ago.
Oh, one, only one. The other, whichever it is an unintentional bigamist.
Oh, my God!
Eh? Who are these young persons?
Who are we? Why, their wives, of course. We've just arrived.
Their wives? Oh, dear. This is extremely unfortunate. Oh, dear, this complicates matters. Dear, dear.
Do you mean to tell me that one of these monarchs was already married?
And that neither of us will be a queen?
That is the idea I intended to convey.
Oh, Tessa, my dear, dear child.
Get away! Perhaps it's you.
My poor, poor little duck.
Don't! Who knows whose husband you are?
And pray, why didn't you tell us all about it before they left Venice?
Because, if I had, no earthly temptation would have induced these two gentlemen to leave two such extremely fascinating and utterly irresistible young ladies.
There's something in that.
I may say that you will not be kept long in suspense. The old woman who nursed the royal child is at present in the torture chamber waiting for me to interview.
Poor old girl. Hadn't you better go and put her out of her suspense?
Oh, no. It's all right. She has my Netflix password. I'll go and interview her, and in the meantime, may I suggest the absolute propriety of your regarding yourselves as single young ladies. Good evening.
Well, here's a howdy-do.
Delightful. One of us is married to two young ladies, and nobody knows which. The other is married to one young lady who nobody can identify.
And one of us is married to one of you, and the other is married to nobody.
But which of you is married to which of us, and what's to become of the other?
It's quite simple. Observe. Two husbands have managed to acquire three wives. Three wives, two husbands, that's... two-thirds of a husband to each wife.
Oh, not Vesuvius. Here we are in arithmetic. My good sir, one can't marry a vulgar fraction.
You've no right to call me a vulgar fraction.
Get me rather mixed. The situation is entangled. Let's try and comb it out.
In a contemplative fashion,
to go.
night attention touches heart of Duke.
And heart of Duchess to reside there.
With profound regret.
She a beauty was a model.
When a tiny tiddle toddle and at 21.
She's excelled by none.
At 21.
She's excelled by none. At 21.
She's excelled by none.
She comes to claim the royal
that His Grace, the Duke of Plasitoro, Limited, has arrived and begs...
Desires.
Demands.
And demands an audience. And now, my love, prepare to receive the husband to whom you were united under such interesting and romantic circumstances.
But which is it? There are two of them.
It is true that His Majesty is a double gentleman at present, but as soon as the circumstances of his marriage are ascertained, he will, ipso facto, boil down to a single gentleman, thus presenting a unique example of an individual who becomes a single man and a married man by the same operation.
I have known instances in which the characteristics of both conditions existed concurrently in the same individual.
Oh, he couldn't have been a Plasitoro.
Oh, couldn't he, though?
Well, whatever happens, I shall, of course, be a dutiful wife. But I can never love my husband.
I don't know. It's extraordinary what unprepossessing people one can love if one gives one's mind to it.
I love your father.
My love, that remark was a little hard, I think. Rather cruel, perhaps. Somewhat uncalled for, I venture to believe.
It was very difficult, my dear, but I said to myself, that man is a duke. And I will love him. Several of my relations bet me I couldn't. But I did. Desperately. Vocabulary most unpleasantly emphatic, philosophical.
shady family he has married into. He will repudiate the contract altogether.
Shady? A nobleman shady who is blazing in the luster of unaccustomed pocket money? A nobleman shady who can look back upon 95 quarterings? It is not every nobleman who has 95 quarters in arrear. I mean, who can look back upon 95 of them. And this, just as I have been floated at a premium. Oh, fine.
Your Majesty is surely unaware that trip to your Majesty's father came before the public he was applied for over and over again.
My dear, Her Majesty's father was in the habit of being applied for over and over again, and very urgently applied for, too, long before he was registered under the Limited Liability Act. To help unhappy commoners and add to their enjoyment, affords a man of noble rank congenial employment. Of our attempts, we offer you examples illustrative. The work is light, and I may add, it's most remunerative. Small titles and orders for mayors and recorders I get, and they're highly delighted. MPs, baronetted, chef colonels gazetted, and second-rate aldermen knighted.
Yes, aldermen knighted.
Foundation stone laying, I find very paying. It adds a large sum to my making.
A sum to his making.
At charity dinners, the best of speech spinners, I get 10% on the taking. To be my daughter. There is some little doubt as to which of you is the gentleman I am addressing and which is the gentleman who is allowing his attention to wander, but when that doubt is solved, I shall say, still addressing the attentive gentleman, Take her, and may she make you happier than her mother has made me. If possible. And now, there is a little matter to which I think I am entitled to take exception. I come here in state with Her Grace the Duchess, and Her Majesty my daughter, and what do I find? Do I find, for instance, a guard of honor to receive me? No.
No.
The town illuminated? No.
No.
Refreshment provided? No.
No.
A royal salute fired? No.
No.
Triumphal arches erected? No.
No.
The bell set ringing?
No. No.
Yes. One, the visitors, and I rang it myself. Not enough. It is not enough.
Upon my honor, I am very sorry, but you see, I was brought up on a gondola, and my ideas of politeness are confined to taking off my cap to my passengers when they tip me.
That's all very well, it's great, but it is not enough.
I'll take off anything else within reason.
But a royal salute to my daughter, it costs so little.
Papa, I don't want to salute.
My dear sir, until it is decided which of us has the right to take that liberty, she shall have as many salutes as she likes.
As for guards of honor and triumphal arches, you don't know our people. They wouldn't stand it.
Oh, they are very offhand with us, very offhand indeed.
Oh, but you mustn't allow that. You must keep them in proper discipline. You must impress your court with your importance. You want deportment, carriage.
We've got a carriage.
Manner, dignity. There must be a good deal of this sort of thing, and a little of this sort of thing, and possibly just a soupçon of this sort of thing.
Soupçon?
And so on. Oh, it's very useful and most effective. Just attend to me. You are a king. I am a subject. Very good. I am a courtier, grave and serious, who is about to kiss your hand. Try to combine a pose imperious with a demeanor nobly bland.
Let us combine a pose imperious with a demeanor nobly bland.
That's if anything too unbending, too aggressively stiff and grand. Now to the other extreme, your tending. Don't be so deucedly condescending.
Sweet to earn the nobleman's praise, capital, capital.
chickens together. That's called tact.
It's really very awkward. We really ought to tell her how we're situated. It's not fair to the girl.
Well, why don't you do it?
No, I'd rather not. You should.
I don't know how to begin. Madam, several of us...
Gentlemen, I am bound to listen to you, but it is only right to tell you that, not knowing I was married in infancy, I am head over ears in love with somebody else.
Our case exactly. We are head over ears in love with somebody else. In point of fact, with our wives.
Your wives? Then you are married.
Oh, it's not our fault.
We knew nothing about it.
We are sisters in misfortune.
My good girls, I don't blame you. Only before we go any further, we must really arrive at some satisfactory arrangement, or we shall get hopelessly complicated.
Oh, more is all happy, all there to see.
Chuka!